I'm here today with an old friend of mine who's an actor and author. I'm just going to let him introduce himself because we've known each other for, 25 years or so.
Wow, yeah, wow, we're getting old. I'm not mentioning age, I'm ageless.
He's ageless, but I've been just following him on Instagram and watching this whole process and everything that's been happening, and he's very outspoken, and he's got a lot of experiences in life and a lot to say, so I'm just going to hand it over to you, Leonard, and introduce yourself.
Hello everyone, hello Atlantis world, that's my introduction. My name is Leonard Clifton, but my friends call me Leo. I've met you, they call you Sliva?
Sliva, yeah.
Still?
Okay.
Man, I've known you since, like I said, 25 years. Started off with a Brother's Keeper.
Yeah, it was my portfolio. Film. It was my portfolio film with Kareem Butler, and you were the lead actor in it.
Yep.
With Sean Lesher.
And right after that time, I remember I did a Cork and I modeling gig. I did Tupac video, and right after that, then I did, the Brother's Keeper, then an ST campaign for Israel.
And did you forget, you did a Young MC music video with my jerseys.
That's right, the Young MC, on and popping. That's right. Dang, we've known each other for a long time. That's right, the Cypress Hill, that was dope, that jersey, I remember.
Yes, and there was San Francisco Spiders. Hockey jersey you wore.
Yeah.
That's like one of my favorite jerseys. And you're like, hey, you got some jerseys? I'm like, here, take whatever you want. And
that's right. Yeah. That's, you've been a good friend from all those years and way back then. Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Great memories.
So we're here. You're actually the first in-person interview, podcast, whatever I'm doing. You know, because everything else has been like people calling in because of the virus. And And I was just like, you know, I want to sit down with you. Why do it over the phone when we live in the same city, in the city that's just like in turmoil right now? So I've been watching you on Instagram, going to the protests and sharing your views and your story on Instagram. But can you talk about like your experience of, because you've been doing it a few days.
Yeah, it's been intense. The first day was last Saturday. I forgot the date it was. The 31st, the last day of the month? Mm-hmm. No, the 30th. So I live in West Hollywood, and literally the protests left from the Grove on 3rd Street, you know, from 3rd and Fairfax down to 3rd and La Cienega. That's like right by me. So I jumped in, joined them, and it was liberating because I'd never done anything like that before in my life. And being an African-American man, seeing protests in the 60s, and that's what it felt like. And you're seeing all these kids from every race, gender, colors, all joining in a unity. And when we stopped it in the middle of La Cienega, literally they stopped the traffic in La Cienega, right in the intersection. So when they were protesting there, when the ambulance come through, they let them through. So. The protesters, the lead guy, they were organized that they let who needed to get through to get through, mm-hmm. especially to Cedars, if you know, because it could be a life and death situation.
Right.
So we sat down, then we start hearing an ambulance. I was like, oh, the cops are coming. You can hear like the kids. And I was like, yeah, we're ready now. And then we marched down La Cienega towards Beverly. And that's when I was like, what the hell? These fucking kids are like tagging the bus. Then they start tagging CBS. And it literally, it was like everybody. It was a lot of white kids doing it. I'm like, I told some, like, dude, you can't do this. I'm black. I guarantee you they're going to think black people were doing this. Can't do it. Like, I'm sorry, man. I just want to, you know, I want to be, you know, active part of the movement, but that's not the way to do it.
Right.
You got to protest peacefully. And I think I got through to some of them. So, my girlfriend, she's like, don't be around, you know, you're not practicing social distancing. She's OCD.
Yeah, no, I totally understand.
Like me too. I have my mask on, you know, and so when we hit Beverly, they made a right, heading back towards the Grove, mm-hmm. it was hot. It was real hot and humid. I live close by. I literally went back home, showered real quick, and changed, and I went back out again. And as I was going, the market by me on, like by 3rd Street, Korean market, and I know the owner, some guy went in, Latino guy, you know, thought I was buying beer. He just ran out. The guy was like, man, what are you doing? So I closed the door. I wanted to make sure everything was safe, but it was fine. Mm-hmm. He wasn't vandalized, far as I know. So I continued to walk back towards the Grove, Fairfax, and Third, and it's like literally in the intersection, it just stopped. There was cops surrounded from Fairfax, where the Trader Joe's is, that perimeter to, I think, Edinburgh. And it was like, then you see the helicopters, about four helicopters, kids on top of her, you know, on the car. I think it was her own car, this young white girl. And they would start chanting, and all of a sudden, she's like, boom, them cop car caught on fire.
Oh.
Yeah, I was like, oh shit. Oh, then I start filming that. I was like, what the hell? And then everyone started chanting, who do you protect? Who do you protect? I was like, man, this is getting real.
Right.
And then there was more cops that came on the other side of Edinburgh. I was like 30 of them, like they're in formation. I was like, oh shit. I've never been anything like that before.
Yeah.
It was like adrenaline rush. It was intense. You didn't know what they were going to do. You know, all those things going through my mind. I was like, damn, they're going to build a club and come out. You don't know what was going to happen.
Yeah, 100%.
And so they were like dispersed. So people start scattering. I'm like telling people, just be careful, be safe. So I go through the alleyway back to my place. You see helicopters circling around. I'm like, damn, are they following me?
Right. Oh my God.
That's how you're feeling.
Right.
But then I get closer to my place where I live. Then you see, I filmed this two big suburban sedans with cops on them. Mm-hmm. All around, like on the rails, like holding on. I was like, oh, I'd never seen that shit before.
Right.
In LA.
Yeah.
It was, so that was real intense. And later on, I found out, later, I mean, like I was telling kids with tagging, you know, start seeing everything with the farmer's market, kids on top tagging, you know, BLM, F the police. I'm like, yeah. You can't do that. So I don't know, you know.
I saw that post that you did about that, and it was just kind of sad because farmer's market are mostly immigrants with their stores there.
Yeah.
Trying to survive, especially during the virus. And it's like, you're victimized by the police and by the government. Why are you victimizing other people that are struggling themselves, especially right now? And that's the part that is, I think, people that are against the protests see that.
Yeah.
And that's where, like, the whole van, like you're saying, like, you're trying to stop people from vandalizing because you're vandalizing and the news is just going to cover that. They rarely cover when you see people shielding police officers or you're seeing stores being shielded by protesters stopping looters from going in. You rarely see that unless it's on Instagram.
Yeah.
I guess this is the only time I think social media is a joke until now. With not social media, you actually get to see stuff that people on the street, then our street reporters posted, kind of like, you know, like NWA when they used to be interviewed. They're like, we're street reporters.
Yeah,
this is what we are.
That's true.
We're showing you, we're telling. Think about this, like straight out of Compton, the movie, how the whole song Fuck the Police came about.
Yep.
They were on the ground. They were getting Billy Club. They were being talked down to, and they're like, fuck it, Ice Cube's gonna write the song.
Yeah.
And this is what, in the mid 80s.
Yeah.
You know, and so there were street reporters back then, and they even used that term. And now with people on social media, they're doing the same thing. And it's wonderful. I mean, like, you know, you had the whole Blackout Tuesday. Then some people had a problem with it. I'm like, why do you have a problem with it? I think nobody should have posted except for people that are protesting. Fine, people posted the black square. I totally get that. I posted it.
Yeah, thank you.
I just really think that nobody should have posted anything except street reporters. But I get it because you want to show at least some
solidarity.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned that. I didn't even think about it in that sense, but I felt so now into it. I felt like an activist because I never did anything like that before.
Right.
And being in that kind of energy, all the positive people, it just wants you want to move, push more and more and more and do more activism, you know, being an activist, right. Protest, and just doing good things.
You know, I think stuff like this, especially with the coronavirus and now this, I think people are just hopefully waking up that there's really much more to life than material things or things that don't matter or value because, you know, human race, we're all together. I mean, like, that's that whole thing, like, saying, like, what if the aliens came down tomorrow? Look at a lot of the alien movies.
Yeah,
the whole
yeah.
planet unites against this one common enemy. And same with the coronavirus. The whole world united against coronavirus. You know, like, people are staying at home. People are social distancing for most part. And now you have this. And
yeah,
this
people is are uniting against racism and, yeah, and police brutality. Is, and you're seeing it in real time.
You're seeing it in real time. Yeah. And that's the part that is wonderful in so many ways. It just, you know, like, and unfortunately the news glamorizes the violence rather than glamorizing. I saw this one video on social media, because the news is not going to cover it, where there was this, there were protesters, they're lined up, and this one young black guy, he was talking to the cops and he's telling them, look, I love you, we're all, and he's just going this whole thing, I love everybody here, we should unite, we should do this together. And the video goes on for like a minute and a half, and you're thinking, how's this going to end? Hopefully it ends in the right way.
Yeah.
Two cops push their way through and they take him away.
Whoa.
And I'm watching this and I'm just like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, this guy is pouring out his soul to you in front of everybody. He's got tears in his eyes, and you could hear in his voice, and all you're thinking about is taking him away. He didn't say, I understand people that are throwing things at cops,
right,
getting in their face, saying right, some things, the cop gets pissed off and he's gonna do what he's gonna do. But if this man, young man, is actually speaking from the heart and this is what you do, then how do you expect people who see this take the cop side, which is sad, because there are plenty of amazing cops, but then you get that.
Yeah, there's a lot of good cops. And the funniest thing, you know, I'm a writer, and look, my book, The Last Prince Atlantis Chronicles, book two is going to be coming out soon, and I wrote it close to 9 years ago, and I just want to write something with what diversity, what a character who's multicultural, black, he's part of alien, but his girlfriend is she's a socialite, she's a Greek goddess, so it's subliminally is like a Romeo and Juliet, but it's that color lines kind of thing, mm-hmm. but they have supernatural powers. Zeus watches them, but in one chapter, it's titled Racially Profiled. Uh-huh. And that's another reason why I want to go out and protest. Even in, I'm writing a sci-fi, supernatural type of book, young adult for kids like the Harry Potter and Percy Jackson's, but the reality, you're black, you may likely get racially profiled. So Alan couldn't show his powers or anything. He had to go along with the scenario, and he knew it was the antagonist character, who's a billionaire, who actually paid these cops to do that. And it's kind of like wondering, like, what's going on now? Like we were talking before, some people, you saw videos of people like loading, like dropping off bricks in front of these stores. Like, what do you think they're gonna do?
Yeah,
with those bricks?
You're giving people weapons, and out of 1,000 protesters, maybe one gets pissed off and takes a break, and then it starts a snowball effect.
Yep.
So it makes you wonder who's in charge, who's doing what, and what's the agenda.
Yeah, exactly, the agenda.
You know, that's the part that's just like so sad, that you would think like our politicians would take control of this, in the sense where like come out and speak as human beings. You know, like today I was actually texting with my brother about this, and
I remember your bro.
Yeah, he's got a couple of kids now. He's a grown up.
Right.
And we were talking about how if Donald Trump really wanted to make a difference right now, he would go and meet with Barack Obama, and they would figure this out. Don't start pointing fingers and saying I'm going to get the military involved. No, how about talk to people as human beings, not as what you think they are, animals or whatever the fuck you think of people that are looting.
Yeah.
Because if you think about this, before, was it a week and a half ago, there was no looting. Still the same problems existed.
Mm-hmm.
Beyond existed. Mm-hmm. And then this was just the straw that broke the camel's back. And that's what people can't understand. They're like, why do everybody care about George Floyd? It's not him. And that's what my brother said. My brother worded it so perfectly. He said, look, it has little to do with George Floyd and his background and everything else. The point is, he was the straw that broke the camel's back.
He was
the
straw that broke the camel's back.
And
yep.
He was the poster of what this shit's all about. Because for whatever the cops did to him, they didn't know his prior history. So it doesn't matter. Your prior history shouldn't matter, because everybody gets a second chance, especially in this country. They're supposed to. And this is the time for, like, if Trump really wants to be president for another 4 years, this motherfucker better get his shit together.
Yeah.
Because right now, he's divided the country so bad with just his words. And his words could unite the country by just having the right people around him. But I think it's an ego thing with him.
We all know that it's getting, we're going down the rabbit hole like more and more with this dude. I'm trying to get out of the rabbit hole. But
yeah.
But this guy literally, when he sends these little small code words, like I remember the movie Parasite, the Korean guy won. He's like, why do we have like movies like this? We need to have more like Gone with the Winds. Yeah. What the hell is Gone with the Wind?
Right, exactly.
Like post Civil War, like slavery, and yeah, so.
You know, that's the thing that's you like I, because I'm you know I'm 50, and I just got him off a bunch of surgeries, so I'm kind of limited to what I can do. So that's why I wanted to like sit down and talk to you about this.
Yeah,
whole thing,
brother.
Because what else can I do? I'm like I could share my stories, and I did a podcast about like me being Jewish in Ukraine and the stuff that my family and I went through, especially my parents.
Oh yeah, the Cold War stuff.
Yeah, the Cold War and being called all kinds of names because in Ukraine it was very anti-Semitic. I don't know how it is now, but it was like that back then.
Yeah.
So, but the one thing that people don't, I guess people can't understand, even if they're getting oppressed for their religion, but they look similar, is that being Jewish, I could be around anti-Semites all day and they will never know.
Yeah.
So I don't have a target on my back.
Yeah.
If you're black, and you can't be around anybody that's got an issue with your race.
Yeah.
Because you have a target instantly on your back, whether you're driving, you're walking, on your phone, whatever it may be. If people right away can see that or hear you, they'll be like, okay, well, you know, if they have prejudged notions about your race, right away you're looked down on or whatever they feel about you.
Yep.
And I think people kind of forget that part.
And that's why another reason why I approach that is because I did have a lot of inner anger from when I was my childhood. When I was a little kid living in rural Texas, the South.
Oh.
Very, very racist town. I remember me and my childhood friends, like 7 years old, being chased by a redneck, 6 years old.
Really?
In a pickup truck. Yeah, we scattered like right after dusk. It was going to sundown. We hid in the bushes.
Wow.
Yeah, there were probably like 19, 20, like four redneck kids in a pickup truck chasing the little smaller kids, which was me and my friends. And when I moved here, years later in that town, one childhood friend was dating a white girl. I guess the dad busted them in together.
Uh-huh.
And he forced her to say that he raped her. I'm hearing stories from the black side and the white side. The KKK came to town.
They really?
Yeah. For real. They wanted to hang him. But the court system pretty much did that.
Yeah.
And then when he went to prison, they retrialed the case. They doubled his sentence.
Wow, my over this, God.
Yeah, he just got out, and he was like, never knew what a cell phone was. My sister gave my number, like, who's this, my number? Like, oh, he was like going through the halfway house. Maybe like 6 months ago.
Wow. And I think that this is, it's kind of like with the LA riots, the reason they happened was because people saw the injustice.
Yeah.
And it was just like, it was targeted anger towards buildings and white people because that's all they saw, because that's what it was. It was like, fucking all these cops in Simi Valley get acquitted. Now it's a little different, you know, so now you're getting people that are finally like, no, this is enough. It was, you know, like, and that's, I think that's the thing is like, as a white person, I'll tell you. So in 92, I was freaked out because white people getting dragged out of the cars and beaten the fuck down, killed, whatever. But I guess in a really fucked up way is that that's what black people have been feeling for, 400 years or so?
Yeah. Well, I can personally say I'm blessed. I grew up in the suburbs. I was a surfer, you know.
We really?
Yeah. There's no pictures of me surfing. But yeah, I was. I mean, I'm an ocean guy. You know, I'm wearing this. I'm all about water conservation, saving the sea animals, you know. You know, when I was traveling around the world, I would scuba dive, occasionally with great white sharks in Africa.
Yeah.
I did all that kind of stuff.
I've been watching your Instagram going, this dude is all over the world in like some of the coolest places. So how does that happen? Like, so what are you doing when you're going out there?
Yeah, I was doing, actually walking through the footsteps of the characters, the book, the original book. It was three books in one. And then after I did, I have the first have a book signing at the Grove Barnes & Noble during Black History Month. And I was like, it was really successful. I'm like, okay. My mentor, now, God rest his soul, Reginald Rutherford, he was like a big producer. He was friends with like Marvin Gaye. He worked on Soul Train with Don Cornelius. He was like one of the co-producers of Soul Train Awards. Mm-hmm. And he like did stuff with Prince. Like, wow. Dude did a lot of stuff, but he always backed me and he helped me get the Barnes & Noble. He was like, you need to do Comic-Con. And then when I created the cosplay characters, the models, and I didn't have like the costumes way it would be if it was a movie made.
Yeah.
People were going crazy there. And uh-huh. San Diego's like, who are you guys? I'm like, now I have it. I decided to do the three separate books mm-hmm. and I hired someone from Breaking Bad. She's a screenwriter. I hired a female. She's Russian, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
We're everywhere.
So she was editing the original book as I traveled the world, starting off with Australia, then I went to Greece, I went to Africa, and Hawaii, mm-hmm. just like the characters in the book. And I wanted to actually show people, especially kids of color, black, Latino, Asian, whatever, like, hey, I can do this, you can do this.
Right. No, that's a great point because, yeah, all you hear is like white people traveling the world.
Yeah.
And hiking and doing whatever they're doing. Yeah. And then you're out there and I'm going, literally, this is what I was thinking. This motherfucker's all over the fucking world. I'm sitting here in West Hollywood in my condo. Good for you. Now, talking about being an African-American, now you're traveling around the world.
I wrote in one of my posts that, I experienced racism pretty much everywhere I've been in my life. But you always got to have like that bulletproof thinking. If racism probably hit you, boom, it just bounce off your chest, kind of say. You have to ignore it. I've done it my whole life. Even though you notice it, you just have to ignore it. That's the only way you can survive. You just dwell on it. You're gonna just be an angry person. You're not gonna be able to even focus. But the worst part was when I went to South Africa. The day actually when I was flying on Ethiopian Airlines, which was so cool. Because when I had to stop in Ethiopia, you saw like I saw a lot of Ethiopian Jews. Mm-hmm. You see like the Rastas, like just like Bob Marley, because that's all like the Mecca, like Ethiopia. I forgot the guy, I can't think of his name, but they were saying that he was the second coming of Jesus. If you watch the Bob Marley documentary, speak about it. I mean, I'm not a Rastafarian, so I can't think of the gentleman's name. But it was so cool just to be in the airport seeing just black Ethiopian Jews and you're seeing Muslims. When I'm flying in Cape Town, I was talking to a gentleman who's flying from Norway, going to his dad's birthday. I think it was like his 60th birthday. I'm like, I'm gonna be filming, I'm shooting this documentary about the characters of my book. I'll explain it to him. But this old white lady was sitting behind me. She was angry just to hear me talk about the positivity I'm doing.
Really?
I'm not kidding you. God. She was like, I'll leave my seat back. So you heard that South African accent. Move your seat. And then we would land. I just want to say, who the fuck is, I'm in LA. But I didn't say anything. When we landed, I put my backpack on. She's like, your backpack's touching me.
Oh my Lord.
And I would turn around, I was like, I'm from LA. I don't play this, but I'm like, I'm in another foreign country. In a foreign country. I'm black and I know about apartheid. I don't know if they may beat my ass for cursing this white woman out.
No, 100%, right? You have to be careful.
And look what happened to A$AP Rocky when he was in Sweden, mm-hmm. when some guys were harassing him. He was just saying they were defending himself. He went to jail.
Yeah, he went to jail, right.
I just want to like, that's why I just had to ignore it.
Yeah, because you don't know the culture. You literally have no idea what they're going to turn around on you.
That's exactly didn't know what it was going to do. And everybody's just watching. There's a lot of black people. They were just quiet. I'm just ignored her because soon I landed and went through customs. I had two guys ready to film me coming in. Uh-huh. And that was going to be the introduction to my documentary. Whenever I finish it, edit, I need help with that. That's not what I do. But I had to keep my energy focused on me coming in. Mm-hmm. And that was all successful. But if I let her energy take me off, that was huge. That was a huge moment. I put my whole life and soul into the book, wanted to do the documentary, inspire kids.
Yeah.
I didn't have one incident of one racist person just trying to make me agitated.
Yeah.
That's the part
that's, I think, is difficult for especially, you know, white people. Because, look, I'm white, and a majority of people I'm around are obviously white.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And I think it's hard for them to understand. Like, and I watch a lot of sports talk because that's what I do.
Yeah.
And especially right now, there's a lot of people talking about it, a lot of opinions. And if people just sat back and listened. And I was listening to Stephen A. Smith a few days ago, and he made a really good point. He goes, do you understand how much every day us as Black people have to deal with it and just internalize it.
Yeah.
Because you walk into anywhere, doesn't matter where, you don't know who thinks what of you. And who's holding onto the purse tighter, and then you'll get people saying stuff like, well, you know, Black people, you know, there's so many Black people that are criminals. And then how about let's pull back this whole thing? It's kind of like with the protests and the looting and whatever else. Let's pull back the reasoning for this.
Yeah.
Because a week prior, this was not going on until this straw that broke the camel's back. Same goes with poor people tend to be criminals because they don't have a fucking choice. So you can't say Black people, a lot of them are criminals. White people that are poor are fucking as bad as anybody else. So for people who say that, it's ridiculous. And then you go like, what about the systematic oppression of people?
Yeah.
And the racism that brings a community down to a point where you're stuck living in a situation where sometimes you don't have a choice. And that's the part I think that, it's like I try to explain to people, and I'm like, if that person even is questioning it, they don't get it. And it's hard for them to understand it. And then was it in Stephen A. Smith, I think it was him who said this, and made such a good point. He goes, I'd rather have white people explain to white people because they'll tend to listen to a white person more than to a Black person because they're going to shut the Black person off right away.
You know, the funniest thing when you say that, my next door neighbor, he's like a designer. He worked for like Massimo, and his mom, they're Italian. His mom, she's like a big realtor. She's an older lady. And she saw me, I was telling her what's going on. But she didn't get it. What I was telling her, like with the protests, like, you know, I had to stop kids from like vandalizing. I'm like, that's great. I'm like, no, it's not great. But I don't think she got what I was trying to explain at the time with the white kids. You can't do that. It's gonna make me look bad. But they helped him. Like, no, that's not helping. But she actually was sympathizing with the people actually trying to make a statement, but you can't do it that way.
Right.
But then later on, I was explaining something. But now she saw some of my stories on social media. She's liking them because now I think she's getting it. She's seeing it.
That's the thing that, like, talking back about like the 92 riots and now, 92 were riots. These are protests with a handful of people that want to turn into something else.
Yep.
Back then, there were riots and they were targeted towards businesses, cops, and white people because of the anger. Now, it's not like that. Like, as a white person, I'm completely not scared. Back then, I was. I drove around with a fucking sword in my car going to pick up my little brother from preschool because I was afraid as a white person. Because I'm like, look what's happening. And I think people, especially back then, they just couldn't understand, why are they doing it? They weren't doing it a week prior. People weren't doing this a week prior.
Right.
These are the things that lead to it.
But you know, the funniest thing, I lived in Ventura County pretty much my whole life. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I was living in Simi Valley. And I was dating a white girl. I was going to school there I was going to school in Santa Barbara. And no one in the complex, I was the only brother. No one said anything to me. Living in Simi Valley, I swear to God, I can remember like yesterday. Mm-hmm. When the riots happened with the cops, you know, we talked about, they were tried in Simi Valley because that's a lot of the cops live out in that area. So
right,
it was their,
that
was their like advantage.
Yeah.
Literally, man, people were moving, pulling the right way like I was an ambulance driving down the road.
Really? Oh my goodness.
People in the complex like, hey, how you doing? I'm like, hey, I'm not going to burn your house down or nothing. Like, now you're talking to me. Right. It was so weird.
Oh my God, that's where it, if you treat someone as a human being from day one, you're not worried about doing these things like all of a sudden, like I have to be extra nice to them because they're gonna think I'm racist or like I don't like your color. It's like, no, just be yourself the whole time and then I have to freak out. And I think this is the problem with what's happening right now with all this stuff is that people just now are going to point. And you see that. You see in the post, I'll get messages from people on Facebook.
Yeah.
And their messages are about like, well, George Floyd did this or this. And I'm like, I don't want to hear this shit because that doesn't matter. What matters is what's happening now and the problem that in 92 should have been resolved. It could have been resolved through four different presidents and it never was.
Yeah.
So now I don't think this country has a choice.
Well, I think the world now is like looking at us. Yeah. We're like the catalyst around the world. Even this thing is going on in France. I hope also in South Africa. Like I tell you, my experience, and I've seen being in South Africa, like that's a lot of gangs out there.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. But a lot of them, they're actually pissed off at other Africans that come into South Africa. They feel like they're taking their jobs, like mm-hmm. Nigerians and whatnot.
Oh, I see, uh-huh.
So it's like that kind of thing. And I would see people on the street, like we're walking, this guy I became friends with, like we're going to this one little spot. I'm like, is this safe? You see this guy talking, he was loud. It was like, y'all just love the white man. I'm like, what the hell am I? I'm in a foreign country, you know?
Oh my God, right, right.
And
yeah, yeah.
I'm just walking with this guy. He's like, no, you're going to be fine. I'm going to keep you safe. That was scary to me because right. I'm black. And this guy who was all ranting, he's actually what they call color. He's biracial. Mm-hmm. They call biracial people in South Africa colored.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, like in the 50s.
That's so weird.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh. So like the biracial people look down on or how does it
work? Maybe it's for some blacks where they feel like they're lighter skin, you know, John Lynch kind of thing. But I don't know. I was only there for like 2-3 weeks, so I really don't know that experience, but all I know is a lot of beautiful South African girls. And there's a lot of brothers dating really hot South African white girls. I was like, whoa. I saw one girl look like, this is like a Leonardo DiCaprio kind of chick. Date this dude. He's like, I don't think I even see that here in LA.
Well, you know what they say, there's no such thing as an ugly millionaire. So
like
quote unquote not ugly millionaire.
Yeah, I had no idea. But back to the writing things, people don't talk about, for example, when Denver won their hockey championship, who was riding?
Yeah, 100%.
They were tearing shit up.
My brother just sent me a meme. It was actually kind of funny. It was like a guy in the hospital and says wakes up from coma in 2020, and the nurse goes, "There's riots in Minneapolis," and he goes, "Whoa! But the Vikings won the Super Bowl."
See, that's a funny. That's a great meme. Yeah,
it's a great meme. You're like, no. There's actually like social protests going on now that need to be.
Yeah, no one won a freaking game, and now everyone gets what Kaepernick. I actually deleted a lot of people, even when Trump was like came president, because you can kind of know that rhetoric where they're going with it. And I was seeing videos then, even in Boston, one guy was like, president was going to get nominated. Is like, all I know is a lot of trees. We got rope. You know what that means?
Yeah, right. That like, yeah.
So he insinuated so much just for him being in office.
Oh, the biggest problem with, like, because Trump turned the economy around, but what he did was he separated the country. Like, mm-hmm. So the economy, people are having jobs, but people are like on edge because of the shit that he says, you know? And the whole thing with Kaepernick was that besides whatever he's doing, Trump pushed it to a point where it became even worse.
Yeah.
Because like, if he just been a politician like he should be, he can't be. It's the ego that keeps, he needs to like jab at people, he needs to like go at people, and that's the problem, is that he, and even now, you know, it's like, be like I was saying, like the, if God, man, if he actually had any inkling of being a human being,
he would be great.
If he reached out to Barack Obama and said, can you be my spokesman, can we talk together to the people? No, but he won't. It's a fucking ego thing. And that's the point you're like, dude, you just lost yourself an election to a guy who's senile. Because Joe Biden's senile, and you're not a human being. So this is this is the problem with the country, period, is that who do we have running? We have a senile old white man who with a shady past, and then we have a crazy old white man with a shady past. Running against each other.
Take your
pick, you know, and unfortunately now with like the division in some ways, well, I think in a lot of ways people coming together, but
I think people are going to come together more so. I honestly do, because just seeing the protesters or the youth, I definitely know, even though there's some doing some still crazy things, because you're seeing some of these actually memes that are doing, like white people of, they're on top of the knee on the neck of their friend.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
oh,
they're imitating. You have not seen any of those?
No.
Yeah.
Wow.
So what I love about Sean King, he's like a grassroots, I think, lawyer, protester. Mm-hmm. So he exposed a lot of people. He didn't want to help get Ahmaud Arbery, like, case ongoing when the guy killed him with the video, got everything. He didn't want to get that started, and creating a protest, putting that guy in jail. Now, you know, the guy who freaking videotaped the murder, he's in, now he's going down.
Right, he should have been stepping up and, like, first of all, as soon as that video somebody had, that should have went straight to the news, because obviously, supposedly the cops had.
They had it for weeks.
And didn't do shit about it.
They had it for weeks because it's all a small, like the small town I grew up in, I was born in, same exact thing. They take care of their own.
You know, like we were talking about earlier about, it, you know, like if you have a prejudice towards a certain religion or you know, your sexual preference, you can't really tell in person, but you can if a person is a different race. So I was working with a guy years ago on this TV show called The X Show. He was a grip electric guy, black guy. And one day we were driving to lunch. I think we were just driving to lunch, and either he or one of his friends was like his friends or him like started telling us the story about him. He had a scar on the back of his head. So he told us the story that he was playing college football in Utah, and he was best friends with this guy. I think they might have been roommates for a few years. Then his friend tells him, let's go fishing. So he takes him out fishing, puts a gun to his head, and shoots him. Because he was a racist. This dude was like full on racist and kept quiet for years. It was almost like this whole, just setting him up.
He was playing a little chess match, set him up until.
And shot him in the back of the head and left him for dead. Luckily, this guy survived. You know, went back into town and told the story, and the guy got arrested for attempted murder.
Wow!
But that's the kind of stuff you don't know. You don't know what people are thinking. You don't be, in, you know, and what they're hiding, and that's the part I think that so many people don't get.
Yeah, I honestly, like hearing that, I'm still gonna be who I am. But when it's like gatherings, a lot of white people, I'm not sure if I'm gonna go.
That's
the old Leo may have changed now, because you don't know someone, you don't know what their intentions, the motives are.
Right.
Actually noticed, I'm like one of the only brothers in my neighborhood. A couple neighbors, honestly, they're so self-entitled how they act. I mean, they're doing some crazy stuff in the building. And now all that stuff going, they're so quiet. They see me, they're just like, they don't know what to say.
Yeah, yeah.
It's funny, I'm the same dude. I'm not the dude who's tearing stuff up. Right, you're the one tearing stuff up.
Yeah, 100%. It's definitely a crazy time in the world. And I mean, like 2020 might be the year that I mean, like we're living history. We're living in history with the virus. And now with this, I mean, it all started off with Kobe Bryant passing, you know, like
the rest in peace, Kobe.
The whole tragedy there.
He was one of my inspirations.
And then, yeah.
For the last Prince Lance's Chronicles, actually, I had to revise just to put him in acknowledgement. When they, in the book, how they salute each other, they pound their chest, fist against their chest three times. That's the Lantern Warrior salute. So I got that actually from Kobe. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, after he scored, he's like, you know.
Yeah, they would pound his chest, or his heart or whatever.
Yeah. So I'll tell you,
I was never a big Kobe fan. One, because I hated the Lakers. I'm a Clipper fan.
Oh, yeah. You know? Okay, I get it.
And he spurned us. But after he retired, the way he changed his whole, and became this, I mean, the charity work he did. All the stuff that he helped so many people, underprivileged people, and in creating all these different organizations.
People don't even know about he was doing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I became a fan of him as a human being. Couldn't stand him when he played. And then he retires, and you're like, holy shit, he matured into a person that's going to make a difference for so many. So and when that happened, I remember where I was. You know, like a lot of us remember the moments in life when certain things happen.
Yeah.
And I remember, and I couldn't believe it, I was walking into my parents' house to have breakfast, and my dad goes, Kobe just got in a helicopter crash. And I'm like, okay. And he's like, he's dead. I'm like, and this is when it hits. You're just like, there's no way. You know, there's no way. This man's got so much...
He's like Superman.
Superman, exactly, 100%. That dude ripped his Achilles in his early or late mid-30s and came back still, and then has 60 points in his final game.
And when he ripped his Achilles, he still stayed on the court and scored and walked himself off.
Yeah, you see other guys just like crying on the ground or holding, and this dude was fucking tough as all hell.
Yeah, he was in purpose of pain. Yeah.
So, and then that happens. Just like, any of us, it could happen to any of us at any time.
But just even with him, but he brought so many people together. Like everyone came together, all colors, races, all around the world.
100%.
Even in China.
Yeah.
He was huge in China. And then some friends were sort of like, "What? Everyone's treating Kobe like he's a god or something." I'm like, "Well, no, he's not a god. He was a great athlete, and he was all about his craft on the court, whether you loved him or not, and just like you said, off the court.
Yeah.
Later, he was about helping.
That's the part that because you don't see a lot of athletes that retire. And
even Jordan still don't do what Kobe.
100%, 100%. You know, and that's the part that's just like amazing what he did, and what he still had to give. You know, that's the part that's sad, is that there's so much more that he could have changed in the world.
Yeah, but it's I still see these memes. People talking about after Kobe died, everything went to hell. Everything.
I know, right? Because then the virus came up.
But honestly, Slava, I can tell you, I do believe in God. I believe in the higher power. This is all this godly design. Because if it wasn't for the coronavirus that happened, and literally, if they didn't film, imagine someone just stopped Floyd from being killed.
Yeah.
If they just, you know, continue to film it and see how he was kneed, that hit so many people in so many different ways. And when he cried out to his mom, a big, powerful black man, crying out to his mother, that I think that's what touched a lot of people too. So much differently than these other things you're seeing, like Ahmaud Arbery being murdered. You see it in that, but you felt little compassion seeing this guy
right there,
dying in front of you.
And how nonchalant the cop is there with his hands in his pocket. On top of him. And that's the point, just like, this man is crying for his dead mother, he's crying for help, and
he's a martyr, he's a spark that
he was the spark.
That created all this stuff from 400 years, and still African Americans did not get any reparations, which was promised 40 acres and a mule, and that's what Flight Lee named his production company, 40 acres. There was no 40 acres and a mule.
Right, 100%.
But yet they got all this free land to all the Irish people came into Oklahoma. They made a movie about it with Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman. All this free land you can stake, but the sweat, blood, tears of the back of slaves who built this country didn't get nothing.
Right.
And that's why I agree with what Martin Luther King. It was like an old speech I just watched recently. I think Usher posted on his Instagram that every immigrant that came here, they had a hard time, but not like blacks. Like, you know, like pull up your bootstraps, and Martin Luther King's like, there is no bootstraps to pull up.
Right. So, well, most immigrants come here by choice.
Yeah, yeah.
Slaves, African people didn't have a choice.
We were stolen.
They were stolen. Exactly, yeah. There was like...
Violence was taken to bring us here.
Right, and then built the country. On their backs, on their death, on their everything. Yeah, and
that's another reason why I love Jewish people, because you know I was an Amistad, remember?
Yeah, I know.
Spielberg
film. Yes,
that's
yes,
what
yes.
woke my ass up. I love Spielberg because after Schindler's List, Debbie Allen talked him into making an Amistad, and I was an extra. I got bumped up, got a part. But dude, I was through all that real chains, butt ass naked on the boat.
So they went. They put you through
the whole like middle passage. Like we're in it for like worked a month. And that like psyche. I was like, man, I love you, Steven Spielberg. It was like crazy. I'm like, I'm working with Steven Spielberg, and he's telling me to say a line and next to Giant Man. And I was like, okay. Then when it comes out, you know what? Most of my friends are like, are you half white? Because I look lighter complexion than the real African. Well, I am from America. I'm multicultural. My great grandfather was Irish. My great grandmother was Cherokee Indian.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. I mean, most blacks in this country are multicultural.
Right, 100%, right, yeah.
Some could be from, we have them from rape or two.
Yeah, right.
I did have a great-grandfather who was Irish. So.
You know, talking about that, I when I was in my second college, I took African-American studies course.
Yeah.
And proud to say, highest grade in the class, 110%. Because, I so... immerse myself in learning all that and in the history, and there was a movie that they made us watch. It was Mandingo.
Oh yeah, and Ken Norton Jr.
Yes,
Ken Norton. I mean
Ken Norton. Yeah. Juniors. Yeah.
Yes, played football. Yeah.
And just to see, and it's so impactful, you know, how this slave owner's wife has a baby and it's black. So the nurses or whoever the women are, they kill the baby, and they tell the slave owner the baby was born dead, and he goes, I want to see the baby, and she's like, no, we're gonna do. And then eventually he sees the baby, and he sees that the baby is biracial, and he right away thinks it's Ken Norton's because he had a good relationship with his wife.
Yep.
And so he goes and cooks him alive.
Yeah, we boil the pot, like get in the pot.
Yeah.
Yep. Like no mess. Yeah.
And then you're just like watching this going, but these are not made up stories. This is real life.
It's
you know, and
the horror. I read a book. One of my friends, she's a someone living in my building. She was like she's a psychologist now. She had a book on what doctors did to black kids, babies back in those times, how they experimented on them, their genitals, and all mm-hmm. kind of like cutting. And then you want to get into the Tuskegee experiment, like shooting black men up with syphilis.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, all this stuff. Yeah, experiment. Didn't, wow. didn't know. Yeah, and they spread it to the wives. Mm-hmm. So many things that people don't talk about if they don't know about the history that was done to black men, especially in the South. And that's why I ain't taking no damn coronavirus shot. You can have it. I'm good.
I did the test.
Yeah, yeah,
last
yeah,
Monday,
yeah.
And it was, well, no, this Monday, and it was beyond brutal. That's all I have to say. It was through the nose. The video I saw was supposed to be through the mouth, and I'm like, cool, I could do the mouth thing. I pull up in there, and they're like, oh, we're just doing the nose one. I'm like, oh my God, I heard horror stories. So I recorded the thing, because I'm like, I got to record this, because let me tell you, I went through 9 surgeries on my leg.
Yeah.
That was, it was quicker pain, but it was as uncomfortable as those surgeries, just because they go so deep with it. Oh my Lord.
I think I remember someone posted like, man, that looks like the movie of Schwarzenegger.
Total Recall.
Total Recall.
You know, the funny thing you say that, because the video I posted, I took the audio from the Total Recall scene where he's pulling out the thing, and I put it over them doing it in my nose. And a lot of people are like, oh, that's really good sound effects. I'm like, no, that's the fractional movie. It literally felt like that, you know? And yeah, it was pretty brutal. But again, like, who knows what the agendas are, right? Like,
yeah.
You know, the coronavirus all seems like it's population control for sickly and the elderly to die off. Mm-hmm. And now this is going on, and like down to like these bricks that are set up everywhere, and who knows who's doing what. And, you know, all the people that have the conspiracy theories about New World Order, it's crazy, because you're going like, are these people right? Because you see so much of it happening that they've talked about.
This is a new world. Yeah. Of all the countries, and we're the only country that's set up like the Vatican, like separation of church and state.
Yeah.
And I was watching something on Amazon. It's called Babylon to America. This guy created this documentary, and it was really profound to me to listen to it, because it was talking about the Antichrist. Who is the Antichrist? It was talking about the papacy, the Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. And all the people they killed. You think about all the Dark Ages, they're killing actually Christians.
Yeah.
Like, you know, all the most wars caused by religion.
Literally every single one of you.
Yeah, know, yeah. It, yeah. And it was a lot of Catholic. I thought about it, like, those are the same ones that actually thought slavery was cool.
What?
You start off with the Portuguese and then to, yeah.
Interesting you bring this up. When I was taking an African American studies class, there was a chapter on religion and about how the owners would teach their slaves that in the Bible it said that the white man is superior to the black man.
Mm-hmm. That's how they used it.
And how they used it. And then when they would find out, when the slaves would learn how to read and they would read the Bible, there's nothing in there that says that. So what the slave owners would do is, because they didn't want to kill their property, they would poke out one of their eyes. So because it's hard to read with one eye, you get massive headaches and things like
that. Whoa, that I didn't know.
So you're reading it. So that's why to me it was just like a lot of it was like, man, you know, it's fucked up that, because you not only bring a whole like race of people here, you change their culture, you change their religion, you change the way they eat, the way they sleep, everything. And then now you expect people to do what? Like, still kind of sit back and let fucking you control them like that? And this is again, comes down to the spark that happened, because people are just like, fuck it, I'm sick of it. I wish more people, because like when I was going to my second college, I was taking an African American studies class. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of, there's this big African culture movement by, I know I'm looking at my time too. Like, I hope
we're good. Just see that little cop car patrolling.
We were actually at a park, and we park on the street, and we have a
in Beverly Hills.
In Beverly Hills. So we're just sitting here on the park bench talking. Oh my God, where was I going with this?
I'm sorry. You were doing your class, your history.
Oh, yeah, the class. And that was right around the time where the African culture, a lot of people were just learning about the African culture. And, mm-hmm. and I think this is where People started using African American as an actual, you know, like title for people rather than just black. Yeah, because there was a lot of people that were getting self-aware. They were reading books, they were learning about the African culture. I wish it would go back to that right now, where there would be more people studying about the history, because there really isn't. You know, especially I mean, I've been out of high school for years.
Right. But
when I was in high school, that part of the history is barely mentioned.
That's,
you know, and the fact that nobody can't get it through their fucking head is that this whole group of millions of people were brought here on ships in chains to come here to build a country, and still to, like, to this day are looked down on.
Yeah, that's the whole still Jim Crow era. They didn't want us to, people to learn about it. That's why when I did Amistad, that woke my ass up. I was like, I started reading books because I wanted to know then, because I didn't even think about it. I'm like, I'm living a suburban life, you know, hang out at the beach, actually date, you know, white girls and you know, every color, but I live in the suburbs. It wasn't really where I live that many black people, but it was still a mixture of the school and whatnot. But after doing a Steven Spielberg film, you, like I said, you have real ass chains, you in a boat. I'm seeing people throwing up, some people getting seasick.
So you guys are on an actual boat?
Oh yeah, we shot in San Pedro.
Oh my God, I thought it was a cassette or something.
We shot on set too in Universal. Yeah. This is gonna be a funny story I'm gonna get into, because I know, you know, the business you're in. Remember they were filming something, this is probably like 20 years ago, out in San Pedro, they were shooting and the boat caught on.
Oh yeah, they were shooting pirates, I think it was.
Yeah. But we were in that same area we were filming.
Oh, that's... In fact, that movie, they supposedly used the same ship that they used for Pirates of the Caribbean.
Uh-huh.
And they were not supposed to, like the owner of the ship or something, rented it out to this production company and didn't have the right to do it, and got into all kinds of shit because Pirates of the Caribbean is like a kid's movie, and now you're shooting pirates for adults movie. Not a good thing to have, because we start recognizing the same sets or whatever, or the same rooms, and
that's funny.
But I actually remember when you were in Amistad, and that was like so cool, because like to us, like you were in our portfolio, Kareem's in my portfolio film.
Yeah.
So to us, it was cool to see some of the actors that were on our movie getting successful and doing stuff. Like Sean wound up doing a bunch of commercials.
Oh yeah, yep. Yep, I remember
that. You did Bring It On.
Yeah, Bring It On. Yeah,
Bring It On. You did Amistad. You did those music videos.
Yep, did those music videos. I did another one called Mutiny. Martin Freeman produced. It was about black soldiers during World War II. And the reason why it was a mutiny, I guess it was this Port Chicago, the area. It was an explosion. I guess in that time it was an explosion. Everyone that was on that base, they were actually allowed to go home, mm-hmm. but the blacks weren't. So it was a mutiny. Mm-hmm. And I was training under Captain Dale Dye. Like, he's like a badass. He was like a Marine.
Yeah.
He was like Vietnam. He does all the films. Like, he was a military advisor from Platoon to Save It Private Ryan, Band of Brothers. Mm-hmm. And literally just like he had us like train, run, do the drills, the cadences. He did the same thing with Tom Hanks, all those guys. So it was kind of cool to be like, you know, to work with those, like with that guy. He's a military legend. But all of that kind of incorporated in the book.
Mm-hmm.
Bring It On has, you know, a cheerleader's a football player. You know, I played a football player. Yeah. So in the book, there's a cheerleader character, there's a football player, you know, just high school stuff. So that was my influence for that film into this.
Talk about the book, because like before we get tickets on our cars.
Oh yeah, yeah,
please,
yeah.
Please promote yourself in the book.
Yeah, so everyone, so I wrote the book, The Last Prince of Lance's Chronicles. Basically, I just want to inspire the world of positivity. So it's about this story about this kid named Alan. He's 15 years old. He has two best friends. One's name is Jake O'Connor and Francisco Gomez. You know, white guy, Latino guy, they're Band of Brothers, but they're... His father was like a salvager, a longshoreman, and he was hired by these billionaire guys from Australia. They were looking for this these relics. They knew it was somewhere in the Caribbean somewhere. So I added some pirate kind of like mythology in it too. So they found a ship that was owned by Blackbeard, and then in this ship, the cargo is these ancient relics from an alien planet. So Francisco steals one of them, and when they hang out on Ocean Drive checking out the girls and, you know, like teens do.
Yeah.
Alan's eyes changed from brown to blue green, real light. And there's like, Triple, man, your eyes changed. Cause like, I'm like, get out of here. And that kind of set everything for he finds out he's part alien. He has power of telepathy, teleportation, can speak to sea animals. And the girl, the love interest is this, her name is Athena Drina. She's like a socialite, but she's a Greek goddess. Mm-hmm. So she knows about the whole history of Atlantis, how it fell, but it's an unpublished book that Plato, she was related to Plato, so it's passed down from generation to generations, from centuries, and whoever kind of has some type of powers, they have that book, but they know when someone who's from Atlantis kind of show themselves, they're there to help. Mm-hmm. And that they kind of connect, and Zeus watches everybody. Zeus is her grandfather, her great-grandfather, and godfather. He don't want them dating, but he knows that she's there to help. She's like the last Greek of the Greek gods on Earth. And if she marries him, he's telling her, you can't marry, like I said, it's like a Romeo and Juliet, mm-hmm. kind of interwoven, kind of subliminally, like, you know, black and white.
Yeah.
You know, you're not supposed to mix kind of thing, but he falls in love with Alan. That's like book two. I'm working on the characters now with Athena and Zeus. It's been great. Like, I did Comic-Con last year in San Diego. It's not gonna be a Comic-Con this year. I was in LA Weekly. I actually cosplayed, and it's like, you're a good looking guy. I'm like, really? I'm like, you know, I'm not in shape like I was back when I was doing, you know, Brothers Keeper.
Yeah, you were freaking ripped,
man. Yeah, I was ripped, yeah. The women's always were like, you're so, like with the dreadlocks and the eyes, like, you're so gorgeous. And that was LA Weekly, one of the sexiest cosplayers of all, like hundreds of thousands
really?
Of people.
I've never seen a picture, I'm like, hey, he's dressed up as, that's awesome.
Yeah. Generally, you go, you know, you have models do it. I decided to do it, filmed it, and that's all going to be kind of, the documentary is all done mm-hmm. when I film, because I just wanted everyone to see just social media footage of where I'm going, what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Like you said, man, you know, Leonard's here, Leonard's there, but I just wanted to actually see, like, black kids who maybe want to get into art, like, hey, you know, expand your horizon. Just don't stay in one
100%, right.
Place, you know, experience, get out. And this book taking me around the world, like literally, it's literally like Percy Jackson meets Aquaman meets Black Panther.
That's fantastic.
All in one.
That's really cool. And where can people buy the book?
They can get it on, you can go on leonardclifton.com and go on to the Amazon, Barnes & Noble, iTunes. If you just Google The Last Prince Atlantis Chronicles, it'll pull up. Book two is coming out soon, Battle for the Crown. That's in, like, right now going through production with the publisher. The thing is, I turned down like 4 publishing contracts. I'm still self-published. I need you guys' support. And I actually made a gripe about it because majority of my fans are white. Mm-hmm. So when I went to go protest, I wasn't sure, like, some people like, you shouldn't do it. You might lose some fans. Because I'm always kind of, you know.
Yeah, 100%.
And myself, because all my friends, I have a lot of white friends, but, you know, I just wanted to go protest. So I start seeing some people in my Facebook fan page start unliking. I was like, oh, some people are pissed off.
Wow.
They're doing it. And I was, so I start saying, like you're saying, like with the Blackout Tuesday, people say support black businesses. But, you know, I start thinking, like, man, I'm putting myself on a limb. The majority of my fans are white, I have some black fans too, Latino fans, Asian fans. But the black audience, they don't read like sci-fi stuff like that. Like,
right.
Mostly white kids read, like, read the Percy Jackson, all those things. That's why I'm trying to change that mindset. You don't have to keep watching, like, Power and Empire and all that. I'm sorry. I'm not into that. I'm into just good sci-fi stuff.
Hello.
Nothing wrong with it. And so that's why I'm trying to change the mindset.
Yeah.
I'm just stuff that I want to see.
It's funny.
Create.
It's funny because, like, you know, you were saying, like, it's kind of like in our heads, it's almost like a stereotype that, you know, like white kids will be more nerdy, quote unquote nerdy, watching sci-fi, reading sci-fi. I have a friend, he's an artist, Terry Alec. In fact, when we're done, I'm going to send you his contact information. He's an amazing artist, right?
Cool.
He's the biggest nerd I fucking know. He's a 6'4 black dude. Heavy set black dude. I don't know if he's heavy set anymore.
In fact,
he lived with me and my roommate in Vegas for a few months till he got hit by a car.
Oh,
he had
man.
To move back, yeah. But he is as nerdy as it comes. And it's all comic books. He draws only, like you know, cool, really comic book style
art.
But he's a total nerd. And you would, even when we talk to him on the phone, you're like, some nerdy white kid. And then when I went to pick him up at the airport, I'm like, look how giant he is. I knew he was black, but I was just like, oh, you're so giant. Like, why aren't you, like, again, stereotype, why aren't you playing sports?
Yeah, like, yeah, it's a lot of black, just, yeah, there's a lot of black nerds out there. Yeah. I didn't really consider myself being a nerd, but I am.
Yeah.
Because I just love reading, you know, just different type of books, adventure type books. I'm a big Dumas fan. You know, Count of Monte Cristo. I'm a big Tolkien fan. Tolkien was the influence on the last Prince of Lance's Chronicles. So same with Alexander Dumas. And honestly, if things really get big, I feel it will. I have a billion-dollar production right here in this book with the right people come together, film it, and and put it out. I would like to produce The Black Count. That's one of the best books I ever read. It's, and Time Rise won the Pulitzer Prize. It's a true story about the first five-star black general who was under Napoleon. It wasn't for this guy, Napoleon, when they really conquered anything, especially Africa. And it was all betrayal and denial. And I was reading that side by side with the Count of Monte Cristo. I was like, whoa, stuff is true. This guy, Dumas, was writing about his father. And you know, they said that the Count of Monte Cristo was the first comic book. That's what started Zorro, what started Batman, The Bourne Identity. All these other films came from the premise of the blueprint was the Count of Monte Cristo.
Wow.
A brother wrote that. They're talking about it in Django too. I should remember you watched Django?
So many times it's ridiculous.
The scene with Christoph Waltz, he was looking at his books, his library, he was like, I see you have a Dumas. I think it said Count of Monte Cristo, Dumas. It's like, yes, French. You happen to know he's black.
That is one of my favorite movies just because it's so, man, it's first of all, to get Leonardo DiCaprio to throw around that word.
Oh, I watched that. Yeah, he hated it to do it. I used to see it to do it all the time. It was a bar right by my building where I live. He goes all the time. Hey, he's so cool. Yeah. No one bothers him because you do, you're going to get your probably butt kicked out.
Right.
But he's such a chill person. He doesn't drink anything. But when I'm there, every time I know he's there, you see the hottest girls come in, women.
My gosh.
I was like, oh, Leo's coming. Sure enough, 5 minutes later, here comes Leo.
That's funny.
Yeah.
You know, when I went to see the movie, I went to see Django with a good friend of mine. He passed away. He was 6'4", probably about 450. That's where he passed away. Black dude. And we went to see it together. And I remember at that time, there was like so much controversy about how many times the N-word was
used. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. Well, that's Tarantino for you.
Yeah, yeah, you know. And so when we finished, he actually went online and he just kind of went off on a lot of people. He's like, he goes, like, I fucking loved it. And they use the word so much, it's uncomfortable, purposely uncomfortable, because you're like, oh, that word is like hurting me now because it's used so much. In a lot of times it's such a horribly derogatory way that it's like embedded in your head, like, this is a fucking, like, a horrendous word. And people need to get that through their fucking skull.
But and that's another story reason why I really don't care for Texas. Texas is who state. I mean, I have family there. I mean, me, the person who went to live from my childhood trauma I have as a little kid, I heard that word so much from white people.
Yeah.
It's almost like your first name. And I'm glad Jamie Foxx mentioned the same thing too. He's from Texas.
Mm-hmm.
He said as a kid, he was always called the N-word all the time. And even going to school, that's the reason why I was saying I just ignored like everything I've done because of those years. You just have to ignore it, because I was in the hotbed of racism.
Right. Yeah. 100. Yeah. I can't even imagine. You know, it's like I did a podcast talking about me being Jewish in Ukraine and how they were calling me this word "zhid," which is equivalent to N-word for Jews in Russia, and I didn't know what it meant. But I heard it all the time. Mm-hmm. I heard my parents being called that. But again, it comes down to, like, if none of us knew, if those people didn't know we were Jewish, because by looking at us, you couldn't tell.
Yeah.
We just blend in. You don't have that choice, especially when you grow up places like Texas or South somewhere. It's right there. It's you. And these people, if they feel a certain way towards you, they can spot you.
I was out there maybe like 4 years ago. I dated this girl. This beautiful Armenian girl, she had a job in Houston, and I hadn't been to Texas, man, probably decades. And I go, but Texas is like a cosmopolitan city. I was like, wow, it's nice. I think I saw a couple interracial couples. Not that bad, but I went to go visit a family member just driving, you know, through the little highway interstate. You're seeing people selling Confederate flags side of the road. And I'm like, yeah, I'm in Texas.
That's the thing, is like with the Confederate black people, like, oh, it's history, but some history needs to be remembered, but doesn't need to be shown anymore. Like, we know what it is. And then that's the, again, like, for white people, they might not have a problem with Confederate flag because it doesn't mean much to them. They literally probably doesn't mean much, like, they don't give two shits about it, but they don't understand that for other people, it's that they don't give a shit about it, it hurts them that much more that it's still around.
Yeah, yeah. I don't think it's ever going to change. In Germany, I heard, like, you don't see anything with swastikas. Like, they banned all that stuff because they're so ashamed of what they did.
Right, 100%.
But here, no.
That's the part that's crazy because, like, in Germany, the swastika thing and even being, like, open Nazi is a horrible thing. And that happened, what, 60, 70 years ago.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
For this country to be that much more ahead, where, like, okay, slavery was stopped that many years ago, and it's still going on, Germany kind of, like, learned and tried to remove it from their society. The fact that it hasn't happened here is insane. It's just insane that many more years and still haven't learned. And
this country was built on violence and
yeah. So, you know,
the militias fighting the British, all that stuff.
I was watching this video she was young, oh my God, probably in her early 20s, Black Lives Matter. I don't know if she was a spokesperson or just somebody that was talking.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the words were so impactful. And she goes, where do we learn looting from? Where do we learn rioting from? And taking people's property. This country was built on looting.
Built on it.
We looted this whole country to take over. We looted other countries to bring people here to build upon a country that's been looted and rioted upon. What a great point.
Yeah.
Oh my
and
goodness.
I saw someone report is like, what was the Boston Tea Party? What was all about? Dumping the tea in the...
Yeah.
What was all about? What I was going to say. I just slipped my mind. But... Yeah, I was watching something. It's funny, like Pinterest. I learned so much stuff about like Greek mythology, and like some stuff was taken from African mythology.
Mm-hmm.
Like for example, like you know, like Medusa had like the snakes.
Yeah.
But the real Medusa, she was like a black goddess. She was like a snake worshiper. She had dreadlocks.
I gotcha. Okay. Also, they turned it in.
Like, well, yeah, some of the other like gods they changed, but on Pinterest, God, where I was going, I lost myself. I saw something. I lost my train of thought on it. But what were we talking about?
It was Medusa, and that they turned into dreadlocks.
But no, even before we start talking about that, we were talking about you were talking about the loot. With the Indians, like, well, how the government, how they really put the Indians control and put them in these, you know, reservations. They killed over 1.5 million buffalo. Which the Indians, you know, hunted and survived on.
Yeah.
And it wasn't for them giving the pilgrims, you know, corn and whatever during the harsh winters.
Yeah.
You wouldn't even be here.
Yeah, right, 100%, right? So, yeah, it just constant. So that's the thing, is it's like, you can't get mad when people are going to start revolting finally. When, for all these years, had the opportunities to change or evolve as a society and not having to do it. Unfortunately, we have this. The protests are fantastic. This violence, maybe the violence is a necessary evil.
Yeah.
You know, like you see that famous poster, by all means necessary, you know?
Yeah, yeah. It took violence for this country, for the militia to have their own against the British and work with the French. And but for me, I'm part of me feel like my Nipsey Hussle, I need my reparations. Yeah. We never receive them. So the reparations you can give me is help me with my book. Like, you're a producer out there, you're an investor. If you have interest on what I'm doing with The Last Prince of Atlantis Chronicles, even my book, Eve the Soul Reaper, she's a white girl that fights Grim Reapers.
this one's written before?
It was written about 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. So it's like a Buffy the Vampire.
Oh, I see.
And it correlates with what's going on right now with the coronavirus, because the Reapers, they give these, the ones who can take the virus, or young teens, they call them, I call them like Junior Reapers, and they do all the bidding for the Grim Reapers, who's hiding out, kind of like some of the stuff that's going on now, the powers that be. So I just basically wrote a French slide. If you write a book, you know, with a white protagonist character, I guarantee you probably get more people noticed. The first book, this is the very beginning.
Right.
But I already had it in my mind. I decided to just put it out. But I just redid Eve the Soul Reaper because of the coronavirus. I'm like, it's so similar what's going on with the coronavirus. I just changed a few things that's so parallel with that. That's it. I just wanted to create different stories. And actually, book three and book Eve, they all come together. Almost like the Avengers. Yeah. It's like that kind of thing. And that could be like a TV series.
Now, where can you get the Soul Reaper?
Eve, Soul Reaper is the same thing. Amazon, Barnes and Noble, iTunes. If you go onto LeonardClifton.com, you click onto the Amazon page, you'll find those books on there too. And Damon John from Shark Tank promotes the book.
Really?
On the page. What? On the website.
That's,
yeah.
That's yeah. Really cool, man. That's really cool. Well, we should probably get back to our cars.
Yeah, we should probably get back to our cars.
Anything else you want to promote? Your social media or anything else?
Yeah, you can just find me on, I'm bad at social media. I needed to grow. You can find me on Leonard Clifton Global Citizen on Instagram, but Atlantan fan page, Instagram, Twitter. If you go onto LeonardClifton.com, there's all the icons for the social medias at the top. Gotcha. You can follow me that way. But once again, if you're investors, you feel that, hey, it's like I have great content, you're interested in knowing more, you may want to work together, hey, I'm open. Because like I said, I turned down 4 publishing deals because they wanted half of my movie rights and they wanted half of my documentary rights. I already filmed and shot.
Yeah, right.
And paid for it. I'm like, I'm not going to put myself out in this coronavirus. I'm thankful for it because it gave me more time to read and watch these documentaries. Actually, I start watching, I know you're a big fan of Rudy Ray Moore.
I love that.
I start watching some of his films I haven't seen, but I was watching the documentary on Iceberg Slim, the pimp, when how they started writing and like how they literally pimped him with the publishing. Like he sold millions of copies of his book.
Yeah.
He didn't really get paid. And that's one reason why I did not sell myself short. A little bit of money sounds like it's good, but in the long run, it's not going to be worth it.
No, not at all. Not at all. You see that with athletes all the time, especially boxers.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You're not this brother. And Sam Cooke. And I was like, wow, it was a tragedy. And that's why I'm not going to just give it up to anyone. If it's the right entity, I'll work with.
Right.
I even got busted. Literally, I'm not going to lie. I was at the Barnes & Noble. With a friend of mine, he's Korean. It's like, he has a friend that could probably turn the book into like a video game. Connection to China. I'm like, I was recording that conversation because I want to make sure she caught me. I'm like, well, we don't do that. I'm like, okay. But me being, people steal people's stuff.
Yeah, well, for sure.
That's why I don't sign.
No.
But I'm all about positivity, and I think I've known Slava for years, for decades, and it's good to see each other one-on-one right now and through all this stuff. And I thank you for letting me have this platform to speak.
No, I appreciate it, because like, I wanted to hear your point of view on this, especially seeing out there.
Yeah, it was invigorating. I really applaud the kids, but like I know it's going to be some backlash. Like you're saying, when they see me, it's like...
Yeah,
them freaking, they're tearing stuff up. No.
No.
Everybody was tearing stuff up.
Yeah. One of the, oh my God.
And I was following Jerry Meeks. He's a cool dude, the guy they call the hot felon. I was walking and he was right by a spot right by me. I was like, he looked exactly like the character from my book.
Oh my goodness.
Last Prince of Lance's Chronicles. If he was a teen, he would be, I'm like, he could be the King Leon character. I was telling him about it. But I didn't have a book or anything on me, but I started following his page, and he was showing stuff when he was protesting in Beverly Hills. He's still here. He could be anywhere around the world. He's a supermodel. He was like, man, these white kids were tearing shit up.
Yeah, that's all you see,
Dolce
really.
Dolce Gabbana, he was surprised when I was watching his page. But that's about it, LeonardClifton.com. Thank you, Slava. I love you, brother.
Yeah, me too, man. I love you too, man. However many years, it's been a long
time. Yeah, yeah. I don't even talk about my age. I'm a Lantern years.
That's right. All right. Well, we're going to go and make sure we didn't get tickets.
Yeah. We'll take a quick picture together and
we'll be done.
Plus all that good stuff. So thank you.
Thank you, man.
For listening.
I appreciate it.
Love you, bro.